was that I've been set free. And we all have been set free.
Amen.
You know, and it's a wonderful thing. And we just want to thank you and give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let me just say, we want to just thank you all for being here this morning. Praise God. He is good. He is good to us. Hallelujah. And we just thank you this day. To be in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen.
What a blessing. What a place to be for peace, for joy, for love. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
There's no place I'd rather be than right here. Right now, hallelujah, because of God, he is everything. He's our everything.
Amen.
So praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. All right. We'll just, you may be seated. We'll open up in prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, I just thank you, O Lord. Father, for those that you have brought here today, and I ask you to bless them, bless their homes, Father. Bring peace, Father God, wherever they are. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for those that are online watching today, Lord, and I ask the same for them, Father God, that you just bring your peace, your joy, Father God, bring your blessings upon each and every one. Lord, and we thank you that you are in this house today. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for being with us. Lord, we just give you praise, honor, and glory in all things. Father, we ask that the word, Father God, becomes our truth, that the word penetrates our minds, our hearts, our spirits, Father God, this day. Lord, it changes our lives more directed to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I will turn you over to Pastor Joe.
Good morning. But you want to make a couple of announcements first. Cameron, will you put the website up for me, please? All right. For those that are online, that are watching us online, and you would like to sow into this ministry to help this ministry continue growing, we got a website right here, www.vancleavewc.org. You can, there's a thing, a button up at the top for donate that you can sow into this ministry. Just a few things I want to let people know about is not this Tuesday, but next Tuesday is Celebrate Recovery's kickoff. We're going to kick off Celebrate Recovery here. And I tell you what, I don't know if you've ever been in any kind of recovery program before, such as AA or NA or any of the other ones. But one of the things that separates Celebrate Recovery from the rest of them is Celebrate Recovery doesn't say, pick your higher power. They don't say that, just choose a higher power. Because to celebrate recovery, we learn that there is only one higher power.
Amen.
The one who died to set us free. The one who took the stripes upon his back, the crown of thorns upon his head, and the three nails in his body to set us free from our hurts, our habits, and our hang-ups. It doesn't matter what kind of problem you got going on in your life. It doesn't matter if it's drugs, alcohol, sex addictions, it doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter if you've been hurt by other people, or maybe you've been one that has hurt people before. That doesn't matter what other kind of hang-ups that you have. None of it matters. Celebrate Recovery is here for you. And most importantly, we want to bring you to the only one that can set you free.
Amen.
Amen. That's what Celebrate Recovery is about. I could go on about it. I can preach a whole message about it. As a matter of fact, I am next week, okay? So y'all might want to make sure that you're here for this one. It's going to be a good one. A couple other things is we are still working on our children's area here. Cameron, can you turn me down some? Is not going through? Okay, all right. Okay, a couple other things is that we want to make you just wanted to let you know about this is we're still working on our children's area so we can have a great place for our children and also to continue having Celebrate Recovery in a place like that as well, too. So also, there was something else I was supposed to announce. What was it? It seemed like there was something else I was supposed to announce. Bring God's children. So anyway, I just want to thank you for everybody that has been sowing into this ministry and been helping out, coming in and working on this building and doing all kinds of things. We had Rachel's niece and nephew here yesterday. They were putting more paint on the building to make it look pretty. I was at work, but they were here and some other people were here working. And we're just trying to make this a great church for you guys. And mostly important, that invites people to come in and to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Amen?
Amen.
I'm going to continue today in our series of the church. The modern church, or the church back then and how it relates to the modern church today. So if everybody would just stand as we go to our foundation scripture on this series. Revelation 1:20 says, "The mystery of the seven stars which you saw in my right hand and the seven golden lampstands. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are which you saw are the seven churches." Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, that, Lord, you are showing us how to be a church today, Lord. Lord, you are showing us right now, Lord, how we can serve you, Lord, how we can love on you, but most importantly, Father, how we can bring others to know who you are, that they can be set free, Lord God. Lord, we ask you right now to just open up hearts, eyes, and ears, Lord God, to what you are saying to the churches today, and Lord, that we can be your church in today's times, in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Today, I wanted to look at the church of Sardis. And there's a great title for this. And it says, Sardis is the corpse and it didn't know it. What are churches like today in this here that we can see in Sardis? Are we a corpse and don't know it? See, Sardis was one of the great cities of the ancient world, the capital city of the great empire. This city actually occupied two locations. The older city was up on the mountain. And the newer city, because the population outgrew the older city, they built another addition to the city, but it was down in the valley. Okay. We have a little bit of technical problems this morning. There we go. Okay. All right. The Greeks referred to it as the greatest of all cities. It was a city of great strength. However, it was a city of the past. See, it was a city that lived on its reputation. They didn't move forward beyond their reputation. They expected their reputation to be everything. You know, and sometimes here in America, we're the same way. We look at the rest of the world and we are America. We're better than everybody else. But you know what we don't realize is that because of the policies that are going into effect today, that America is becoming a third world country. Mm-hmm. I can show you right now pictures. You can go to any news agency and look at San Francisco and it looks like you're looking at maybe Guatemala or something like that. People living in the streets. The filth is everywhere. But we can't live on our reputations, and that's what Sardis was doing. It was living strictly on its reputation. It was a city that spoke of life, but in reality, it was a city that was dead. The Church of Sardis holds a tremendous warning for us today. America can relate to the message that Jesus gave this church. This message has no good words to the church. In all the others, Jesus complimented the church. He told them what good they were doing about their church and then followed with his condemnation. Here, is condemnation only. No good words to this church. The first thing I want to look at is the church relied on its reputation. In Revelation 3:1, it says, "And to the angel of the church in Sardis write, these things says he who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your works, that you have a name, that you are alive, but you are dead." Here's Jesus telling them they're a dead church. You know, in the previous letters, every time Jesus said, "I know your works," it was a comforting phrase that he used to them. He always said, "I know what good things you're doing." But here, he's not doing that. Here, when he's speaking to this church, he's speaking of condemnation. See, in all these other churches, when he says that "I know your works," because they were working for him, they were striving for him, they were loving on him, but not the church of Sardis. Remember, he uses the word "new" here, not Gnostic. You know, we've been talking about this word, not Gnostic, but "adu." And what "adu" means is that he is perceiving with his eyes. He is experiencing what's going on. He knows it because he's watching them. This is not just a Gnostic knowledge, but this is a perception knowledge that he can perceive what they're doing. And when he says this here to them, he says, "I see what you're doing," but it was not in words of comfort. You know, at Christmas time, we sing that song, "Santa's Coming to Town." You know, he's making a list and he's checking it twice. He's going to find out who's naughty or nice, right? But see, we don't need to worry about Santa's list.
Come on,
right?
Come on.
We don't need to worry about if Santa thinks we're naughty or nice. Okay? But I'm going to tell you something. There is somebody making a list. And you may want to make sure your name is on it. And his name is Jesus Christ. Amen. Because he's making a list of who's righteous or not.
Uh-huh.
Amen? And if you don't make that list, that's another sermon. I won't go down that rabbit hole today. I went down a bad one last time, okay? The church of Sardis had a reputation in the region of being a going and growing church. Do we not see some of those in even in our culture today? Man, we talk about these churches. Man, look at that church. They're so big. They got such a big congregation. They're growing and they're going places. And all the hip people, all the high class people go to this church. I mean, man, when they walk in this church, the ladies has got formal gowns on. And the men have three-piece suits on, you know. There was a church not far from where I grew up. And thank God the church is not like that today. But this was a church where if men didn't come in a suit, a woman didn't come in a nice dress, they were turned around at the door and told to go home and change.
Come on now.
All right? I'm going to tell you something right here at Van Cleve Worship. I don't care how you come as long as you got something on.
Amen.
All right? Please be dressed. But I don't care how you're dressed. Okay? When I was 17 years old, I was my pastor, the little church that I grew up in, asked me to lead the singing. Now, I realize now that's not the best thing for me to do is leading the singing, but I did. And I was in there, I was talking to the pastor about what songs he wanted to do, because he was not only our pastor, but he was our piano player too. And this guy comes in and had this big van, and he would go around and pick up people. Excuse me. And he comes in, he says, "Hey, Pastor," he says, "remember those kids that I brought to church last week?" And the pastor says, yeah, I remember. He says, "Well, you might be upset with me." The pastor's like, "Why?" He says, "Well, when their mom came to bring them to the van, I told her, get in the van and let's go to church." He goes, "Okay, why would I be upset?" He says, "Well, it's what she was wearing." She says, "She didn't have anything to wear, and I told her to come just as she was." He says, "Okay." He says, "Well, why does she wear?" And he says, "Well, she's wearing a halter top and short shorts." Pastor said, "Okay." So we went in there to start the church, and I got it behind the pulpit, you know, turn in your hymnals to page 375 or whatever number it was that we were doing. And I looked on this church. It was a small congregation, but a pretty good-sized building. And on the very back pew by the door was this lady. She sat, and you could tell she was very, very nervous about being there. And we did, I led the singing, and the pastor came up and he said, I had a great sermon today, but that's not what God's leading me into. And he preached a sermon that had Peter and Paul running up to the front to get saved. And that lady came up, she knelt at the altar, he took off his jacket and he put over her, and she accepted Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior.
Amen.
He told me this, and something that stuck with me, he says, if I would have told her to leave, and she walked out that door and got hit by a car, her soul would have went to hell. But her blood would have been required at his hands. So we can't be a church that wants to be all hip and wants to have all the important people there and just be all big and everything. Like I said last time, what this church needs is we need the drunks in the churches. We need the drug addicts in the churches. We need the homosexuals in the churches. We need the prostitutes in the churches. We need the liars in the churches. We need the thieves in the churches. We need them here because here's where they're going to know who set them free. And the only one that can set them free is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
But see, Sardis, they were the hip church. They had it all going for them. Everything was about their reputation. You know, our churches today, they have these large, lavish buildings, huge congregations, and that is all they base their religion on. But there's a reality. Matthew 23:27-28 says, what sorrow awaits you, teachers of religious law, and you Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, beautiful on the outside, but filled on the inside with dead people's bones and all sorts of impurity. He said, outwardly, you look like religious people. They look righteous, right? He says, outwardly, you look like righteous people. But inwardly, your hearts are filled with hypocrisy and lawlessness. It doesn't matter how beautiful you make the pig look. All
right?
You can put lipstick on it. You can put a nice dress on it. You can perfume it up. But it's going to head to the mud. Because that's what's on the inside of it. Something we need to understand. When it comes to Jesus, the matter of the heart is always the heart of the matter. The matter of the heart is always the heart of the matter. God don't care what you look like on the inside, on the outside. God don't care what kind of dress you wear, what kind of sports suit you wear. He don't care what kind of car you drive. He don't care what kind of house you live in. It's the heart is where he's going to take up residence. Is there room in your heart for Jesus? If not, make room. See, man's evaluation is not always the same as God. Man evaluates your success by how well you dress. Right? What did it always say? Dress for success, right? Man evaluates your success by what kind of car do you drive. Man evaluates your success by how lavish is your home. But see, that's not where God evaluates you. God is going to look at one thing and one thing only. Your heart. Your success on God is defined by the condition of your heart. See, the church needs to consider what Jesus says rather than what man says. We're too prone to be concerned about what we think of each other and what people think about us. Rather, what we need to be doing is thinking about, what does Jesus think about that person? What does Jesus think about you? Are you where Jesus needs you to be? Right. You know, I have a job where I have an opportunity to come across all kinds of people, from the rich to the homeless. Right? And the thing is I was told one time by a homeless person, he thanked me for being so kind to him because nobody else was. But you know, the thing is we need to be that with every person, because every single person Jesus died for. And I'm going to tell you right now, I've said this before and I'm going to say it again. If you ever get to the point where you can look at one person in this world and say they're not worth Jesus, you better check your own heart.
Amen.
You better check your heart, because you're not where Jesus was. All right? What does it say in Hebrews? I think it's Hebrews 10. No, it's in Peter. I can't remember the address right now, but it's in 1 Peter. He says that he would have that none would perish, but that all would come to salvation. None. Not one single person. God never made hell for a single person to be in.
Amen.
But there are people going there because of their heart. And there's a lot that's going to be there that think that they should be in heaven. All right, I'm starting to get down another rabbit trail. I got to get off of that. But see, we need to be more concerned about what the Lord thinks about us and what other people, not by what man thinks about him. Notice the reality concerning the church of Sardis. See, what appeared to be a flourishing church on the outside, Jesus said that they were actually dead on the inside. The church gave every evidence of a growing and moving forward church, but Jesus said they were dead. Here was a church that was dead and didn't even know it. We're talking about a church that was large. They had a huge, lavish building. Every one of their pews were filled. You know? I mean, they were growing. They outgrew their church so much that they had to add on to it. They had to make it look really nice because all the people that were going there. But see, these were people that were going to be seen and to see what was going on. But inside the church, the people were dead and didn't even know it. See, Jesus is not concerned about what activities your church engages in. Not at all. The promises that we make or the things that we do. Rather, he looks at the heart. Remember the story of Samson in Judges 16:20? He didn't realize his strength had left him. He relied on his reputation. But when Delilah cut his hair, God's spirit left him and the strength left him. And he didn't even know it. He got up thinking he was going to shake everything off like he always done, but it was too late. His strength was gone. So what are some signs of life in a church? Number one, there's growth. Not just numerical growth, not just people coming into the church, but there are many different kinds of growth. What are some of the growths that we're going to find in a live church? Growth within the life of the church family. We're going to grow as a family. The people are growing spiritually. Growth in faith through service. The people are wanting to serve the church and serve Jesus Christ. Growth in being a witness for Jesus Christ. They just can't wait to get out and tell somebody what Jesus has done for them today. Growth in stewardship of time and money. There is compassion and love for each other in a growing church. And love for the lost. We have to understand it. We have to love those who are lost.
Amen.
Sometimes we might not like them, but we have to love them. There's unity in a growing church. Division and schism are a sign of death and decay. And there is emotion. Don't be afraid to feel your faith. Only those who, only the dead have no tears, no laughter, no music, and no sorrow. So what are some of the things we can see in a dead church? In a dead church, everything goes back to the past. Well, this is how we've always done it. Right? You know, they say that's one of the things that kills a business, too, is this is the way we always done it. Churches live in the past. They live on its reputation and its history. When a church is more concerned with form and ritual, the church is dead. I'm going to say that again. When a church is more concerned with ritual and form, it's a dead church. Because they can't get past that. When a church is more concerned about church activities rather than God being glorified through those activities, it's dead. Amen. When a church loves the system more than it loves Jesus Christ, and when it loves it more than the people that's around that church, it's dead. When there is more material than spiritual, it's dead. A church is either growing or it's dying.
Amen.
Right? It's either growing or it's dying. If a church is dead, the people are dead because the people make up the church. But a church that is alive is because the people inside the church are alive in Jesus Christ. They're growing spiritually. When people feel as if they just show up on Sunday and they've paid their dues to God, that's a sign of a dead church. See, these works are not perfected before God. It doesn't matter what kind of program you got going. It doesn't matter how many outreaches you have. You can have a great thing for the youth to come to and for the children to come to. And man, you got all this stuff going. You got a church's football team. You got a church's volleyball team. And you go to church and man, on Monday nights, they got movie night at the church. And on Tuesday nights, they got, a dinner on the ground and all these things. And all this is great. But when it doesn't glorify God, it's a dead church.
Right.
Amen. Jesus has not called us to be a dead church. He's called us to be alive. And we can only be alive in Him. So see, there is a remedy for a dying church. You know, just like whenever we feel like we got something going on in our body. We might feel like we might be dying. Right? We call the ambulance, take us to the hospital, and the doctor starts giving us medicine. Starts an IV on us, gives us medicine, and starts getting us where we're better and that we're well. They tell us to go to home and take this medicine all the time. See, it's a remedy. It's a remedy for what ails us. And there's a remedy for a dying church. Revelations 3, 2 and 3 says, "Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain, that you are ready to die, for I have not found your works perfect before God. Remember, therefore," when the Bible says therefore, you know something? It's there for a reason, right? Okay. "Therefore, you have received and heard." He said, "Hold fast and repent. Therefore, if you will not watch, I will come upon you as a thief, and you will not know the hour I will come upon you." What is the remedy here for a dying church? Get back to the basics. Simply, get back to the basics. See, Sardis was urged to get back to the basics of the Christian faith. The truth that they heard when they first believed in Jesus Christ. But that's not what they wanted to do. They were moving away from the basics. And that's why they were dying. Jesus said to strengthen the things which remains. What remains? The basics. The basics of praying. The basics of preaching wholesome messages. The basis of teaching good lessons and witnessing to others. This is the basics that God has called us to be in. He don't care how lavish your building is. He don't care what kind of outreaches you have. All he cares about are you doing the basics. You know, you say, well, Pastor, I'm not called to be a preacher. Well, maybe you're not called to be the pastor of a church. But you know something? When you tell people about Jesus Christ, you're being a preacher. I had an uncle that recently passed away, and my aunt, his sister, she called me up, and she said, Joe, she says, I talked to Fred the other day, and he said that he wanted to get saved, but we had went to church. I brought him to church, but he just didn't have the strength to get up to go up front, and he told me about this, so I led him in a prayer. He says, but does that count? He said, because I'm not a pastor, does that count? I said, absolutely that counts. Anytime that you lead somebody to repentance in Jesus Christ, it counts.
Amen.
Because it's a heart change. It doesn't matter that they come up front and they get wet every Sunday. They can do that. When I was 9 years old, I was in the church, and I went up there every week of vacation Bibles, every day of vacation Bible school, 5 days in a row, and got saved and got baptized all 5 days. But there was no heart change, so it didn't count.
Amen.
But you know, when I was alone in my bedroom, and God gave me a vision of my grandmother in heaven, and I prayed on the side of my bed, not with the preacher, not with the priest, not with anybody else, but just me before Jesus Christ, and asked him to change my heart, that counted.
Amen.
So when you lead somebody to Jesus Christ, guess what? It counts. That's the basics. That's the praying. That's the preaching. That's the teaching. That's the witnessing of Jesus Christ. You say, well, I don't know if I can witness. Do you tell people what happened to you in your day? How about when you and your spouse get into an argument, do you go and tell your best friend what happened? You're witnessing. All right? What is a witness? When somebody's called the court to be a witness, all they're doing is telling the court what they saw and heard.
Amen.
What did you see Jesus do for you in your life? What did you hear him when he spoke to you? That's witnessing, and you can do that. See, if it's not about Jesus, it's not witnessing. We call it gossiping.
Amen.
And all of us love to gossip, right? That's gossip about what Jesus did. Hallelujah. But see, we have to strengthen the basics. How do we strengthen the basics? 2 Timothy 2:15 says, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. See, it's important to grow and gain the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ and to deepen that understanding through careful study. And let me tell you something. You don't need to be in a study group to do that. All you need to do is open your Bible and let Jesus speak to you. It's a live and living word. And he will let you know right where you are. And he will let you know what he is speaking to you in that truth. There's times that I'm listening to my word on my phone, or Pastor Rachel is, and something will come across like, I never saw it that way before. I've heard it, I've read it, I can't tell you how many times, but suddenly a revelation comes. And see, that's Jesus teaching you something. That's studying. Don't let your Bible get a bunch of dust on it. All right? Open it up. Because I'm going to tell you something. This right here, it's a book. This is just a book. And as long as it's sitting on your shelf, it's sitting on your table or your nightstand or wherever it is, this is just a book. Right? But when you open it and you start getting the words in this book off of the pages of this book, and you start getting these words in your heart Then it becomes alive and a living word inside of you. The Holy Spirit can speak to you and bring life to your mortal body through this book. But if you don't open it, it's just a book. Amen. So he says, study to show yourself approved, a workman that needed not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Why do we have to divide the word of truth? Because there's going to be a lot of people going to even come with this book and try to tell you what it says, and it's not really what it means at all. But you got to have the wisdom in your heart. And listening to the Holy Spirit to say, that is not true. You know, I've had people tell me all kinds of things about this. You know, I told the story one time. I was in the dollar store wearing a printed t-shirt and a pair of cargo shorts. And the guy told me I was going to hell. And he said, the Bible said so. I said, really? So I pulled out my Bible out of my cargo shorts. I said, show me. And he couldn't. But see, I could have took that as truth, but I knew the truth. Why? Because I studied the word. And I knew what the truth was. We have to deepen our understanding through careful study. Only through careful study can we rightly divide the word of truth from heretical compromise. Remember, we've been talking about these other churches that Jesus has something against them. What was everything that was against them? It was heretical compromise. They compromise with the word, with the world, I mean. They compromise with the world, and they allow heresy to invade their church. What is heresy? Any teaching that is not of Jesus Christ. If it doesn't come from this book right here, it's not the truth.
That's right.
See, we have to have a fundamental truth of Jesus Christ in which to stand fast on. What did we talk about last week about standing fast? I mean, to hold the line, all right? But you have to have a foundation that which you stand upon to hold the line on. If you don't have a good footing, go play tug of war in the sand. And you don't have a good footing, what happens? All right? See, Paul told us in Galatians 1, 8 and 9, he says, but even if we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you than what we have preached to you, let him be accursed. Well, that's bad right there, right? Let him be accursed. He says, we have said before, so now I say again, if anyone preaches any other gospel to you than what we have preached, let him be accursed. When we don't stand fast to the fundamental of the gospel of Jesus Christ, we can easily fall into heresy. Why did Paul give this warning to the church at Corinth? Because they were starting to listen to people who were preaching a gospel other than the gospel of Jesus Christ. All right? Jesus warned them that they will, that he will come as a thief in the night. See, we're told in Matthew, Jesus said that if a thief was coming, if a man knew that a thief was coming, that he would stay awake and he would not allow the thief to break into his house. Right? I mean, what's the advantage of knowing when a thief, what's the advantage to a thief when the people know that they're going to be coming there? You know, no thief comes to a house and puts a note on the door, says, tomorrow night at 12 o'clock midnight, I'm going to come in and break into your house and steal your stuff. Because what would happen if he did? All right? It would not be wise to do that at my house. I've got two pit bulls and I've got firearms. You may not make it out, you know. But when they don't know, how do we know when Jesus is coming? Because we have the fundamental gospel that is before us. We see the signs of the times. What did Jesus tell the disciples? He says, you know that when there's a red sky at night, that the weather's going to be good. But when you see a red sky in the morning, it's going to be bad weather all day. He says, you can see the signs of the weather, but how can you not see the signs of the times? Yeah. All right? I preached at the beginning of this year about the signs of the times. All right? No, it's the end of last year. I'm sorry. The end of last year, I preached on the signs of the times. How can we know the signs of the times? What are the signs? They're in the gospel. They're written. He tells us. And when we start looking for the signs of the times, we know when he's coming. And we have the foundation on which we can stand upon and hold fast to his word, that we can't be pulled off of it, because we have a sure footing in Jesus Christ. Because we studied to show ourselves approved.
Yes.
And we don't need to be ashamed.
Amen.
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 So now we have the remedy. So now I want you to go home, and I want you to take your gospel
right.
Every single day.
Yes.
All right?
Yes.
If things are coming against you, take your gospel twice a day. You can even take it 3 times, 4 times, 5 times a day, how many times you need it, because that is the remedy.
Amen.
For the devil's attack in your life, all right?
Yes.
Don't be a dead church. Be a live church in Jesus Christ. How many people are alive in here today?
Yes.
All right? I want to hear some live people in this church today.
Yes.
You know, there was one good thing about the church of Sardis. That he said. He said there was a remnant. In Revelations 3, 4, and 5, he says, you have a few names, even of Sardis, who have not defiled their garments. And they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments. And I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. See, there was a bright spot even in a dead church. And among the ungodly and the disinterested, a remnant of righteous people remained faithful. And Jesus was pleased. Though the church was dead and no remedy was offered to it except for what the gospel was, Jesus had a few that he could be proud of. See, you know, Elijah was in the same situation. Remember Elijah, man, he was on fire for God. Man, he had just went and he called all the prophets of Baal up to Mount Carmel. And he says, come on, we're both going to build an altar. All right? We're going to put a pull on it. You sacrifice yours, I sacrifice mine. He says, I tell you what, I'm even going to let you go first. So they sacrificed the bull on the altar. He says, but there's one catch. Neither one of us is going to set fire to it. He says, if Baal be God, let him send fire down and consume his offering. So these 450 prophets were all gathered together, and they were screaming and hollering out Baal, and Elijah says, I don't hear nothing. Wait a minute. Scream a little bit louder. He might be taking a nap. Right. Wake him up. They screamed. They began cutting themselves. He says, well, maybe he's in the latrine. He's relieving himself. But no fire came down from Baal. He says, now. He says, I'm going to show you that there is a God in Israel. And as soon as he said that, fire came down from heaven, not only consumed the offering on his altar, but it consumed the offering on the offering to Baal as well, too. It showed that God was a God in Israel.
Yeah.
Man, I tell you what, he was on top of the world, right? But he ran because Jezebel said, I'm going to kill you. Like these prophets of Baal was killed. He ran all the way to the mountain of God, where Moses received the Ten Commandments. And he said, I am alone. There's nobody else that serves God. But God told him he had 700 other people that never bowed a knee to Baal. He was not alone. See, the devil wants to make you feel like you're alone. He wants to make you feel like it's just me. I'm fighting this all by myself. Why do you think the devil wants to keep you out of church? Why do you think on Sunday mornings it's, man, the weather just doesn't look good. I'm just going to stay home. You know, the Sunday morning is, I don't know. I just feel kind of tired. I worked pretty hard yesterday. I think I'm just going to stay home. Right? Why does he want to keep you at home? Because you're not in with the brothers and sisters that's going to strengthen you. Amen. When you have something coming against you and it seems like all hell is coming against you, that's the time to get with brothers and sisters. That's the time to get into the herd where there's horns and hooves that's going to kick the devil's head in. All right? Don't be his lunch.
That's right. Come on.
Be his conqueror.
Yeah.
All right? The Bible says that he's already been conquered. All right? Jesus has won the war.
Mm-hmm.
All you got to do is stand in the victory. But you do that by getting in with God's people. See, though the church was dead, there were people in there that never bowed to the world system. And we can be faithful even among the faithless. We can be sincere among the hypocrites. And we can be humble among the proud. We can be separated from this world even though we're still part of this world. Even when we live or work in ungodly places where it can be difficult to be a Christian, God can keep us there. You know, one thing is I have a reputation at AMR of not using foul language. And that's my faith. I've had people try all kinds of ways to get me to curse. I even had a partner one time that she had got cancer. And she said, my make-a-wish is to hear you say a curse word. Well, praise God, she's cured from the cancer, but she never got to hear her make-a-wish come true. And I tell them, because it's not in me. The curse has to be in me to come out of me. What's in me is the gospel of Jesus Christ, the love of Jesus Christ. So even in a faithless, hard world, I mean, we can still be faithful to Jesus Christ. Why? Because we have it in me. How do we get him in me? Because we study to show ourselves approved. And we don't need to be ashamed. And it says, when we're faithful, Jesus said we would receive the white garment. See, the white garment is a symbol of purity and righteousness. We got to be careful. It's not our purity. It's not our righteousness that we put on. The book of Isaiah says that our righteousness is but filthy rags to the sight of God. Right? But it's the righteousness of Jesus Christ that we put on, that we're clothed in. See, Adam and Eve, they were in the garden for however long they were in the garden. I think they were in there for a very long time. I just cannot believe that they were in the garden and then the next day they ate of the peach. Okay? You know, I said it had to be a peach in order for me to eat it, but I don't believe they ate the peach the very next day. I think they were in there for a very long time. But it says as soon as Adam ate the peach, they realized they were naked. Why? Because they were clothed in the righteousness of God. And when they sinned, they lost that clothing of righteousness. Right? And they were naked and ashamed. But he says that if we're faithful, that we will put on that righteousness of God. We will put on that white robe that's brighter than any white, that Clorox can never get at that white. Amen. Only the blood of the Lamb can get it that white.
That's right. Come on.
And then he said that he will not blot our name from the book of life. Now, here's a revelation for you. Listen closely. I'm fixing to give you a revelation here. If your name can be blotted out of the book of life, first it had to be written in the book of life. All right? Whose names are written in the book of life? Philippians 4:3 says, "And I urge you also, true companions." Here, get this here. He says, "True companions, help those women who labored with me in the gospel and with Clement also and the rest of my fellow workers." Okay, now see, he's giving you a condition of who is written in the book of life. Right? True companions, right, and fellow workers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not the people that are living for the world. Not the people who are out there raising all kinds of cane. Not that they're the ones who are in the bars all night and then sleep all Sunday morning so that they don't have to come to church. Not those who are living in the filth of this world. But those who are fellow workers in the gospel of Jesus Christ whose names are written in the book of life. Does everybody's name get written in the book of life? No. Not everybody. How do I know that? I want you to look at Revelations 13:8. He says, "All who dwell on earth will worship him." Talking about the Antichrist in this case. He says, "Whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world." Their names were not written in the book of life. They never had an entry in there that had their name beside it. So guess what? Those who come to Jesus Christ to know him as Lord and Savior, when their names are written in, he says, be careful that your name is not blotted out. You're saying, "Pastor, that means God will take away your salvation." Not at all. I'm not saying that at all. God's not going to take something away from you that he gave you. But I am going to tell you this, and you better be careful. You can walk right on away from it. If you choose the world over God, all right, hear me. If you choose what man thinks about you rather than what God thinks about you, if you're tired of being at church and you want to walk away from it, you've walked away from your name in the book of life as well too. It's not God's choice, it's your choice. When our names are written in the book of life, Jesus will confess us as his own before the Father. You know, this kind of reminds me of my dad. My dad was my stepdad. Right? He became my dad when I was 9 years old, one of the greatest men that God has put into my life. And I loved him with all of my heart. And I'm so glad that I got to be the one to lead him to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. So I know I get to see him again. But see, my dad, when we would go around and people that he knew and he would introduce me, he wouldn't say, "This is my stepson." He wouldn't say, "This is my wife's son." He would say, "This is my boy." Amen. He said, "This is my boy." He had ownership of me in our relationship. And that's how he introduced me. And I'm going to tell you right now, when you come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, when you come to rely upon him and you build such a relationship with him, all right, he doesn't introduce you to God and say, "Yeah, this is one of the people that came to know me." He's going to say, "Father, this is my boy. This is my girl. These are my children." He's confessing you before the Father and all the angels because of the relationship that you have with him. Yes. Remember in Matthew chapter 7, when he tells the ones, "Depart from me, for you workers of iniquity, for I never knew you." That word "knew" is the word ginosko, which means relationship. Mm-hmm. Right? It means an intimate relationship. When you develop an intimate relationship with Jesus Christ, he's going to introduce you as his own. Yeah. My boy. my girl before the Father, and all the angels of heaven will know who you are.
That's
right. See, Sardis was a church that had died, but never even knew it. Why did they die? Because they lost their love for the Lord Jesus Christ and for fellow human beings. Their growth had stopped both physically, but most importantly, their growth stopped spiritually. We can even grow physically as a church, but if we're not growing spiritually, we become a dead church. Kind of reminds me of a cemetery. Right? See, a cemetery grows. Right? Right down this road over here, at the end of this road here, there's a cemetery. And every once in a while, you'll see the cemetery grows. Another body is added to that cemetery. But that cemetery is dead. These people are not growing spiritually at all, right? Because they're dead. Van Cleve Worship Center is not a cemetery.
Amen.
All right? If we got dead people in here, I'm going to introduce them to the real cemetery. But not in this church. Amen?
Amen?
We want live people in this church. Say, I'm alive.
Yes, I'm alive.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Remember what Jesus said in John 14:6. He said, and Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and look at this, the life.
Yes,
he is the life.
Hallelujah.
He has made, that's what makes us alive, is because we're alive in Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
Only in Jesus Christ can we be alive, right? He says, no one comes to the Father but by me. To come to the Father, we have to be alive in him. He also said in John 7:38, he says, he who believes in me, as the scripture said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Living water. That's what's going to be in our, come out of our hearts, because we are alive in him. Amen?
Amen.
The church today needs to be a living, Holy Spirit breathing church of Jesus Christ, or we're going to be a cemetery. You know, my dad used to tell me this joke all the time. He says, he'll say, why do they put fences up around cemeteries? And I said, first time I said, like, I don't know, Dad, why? He said, because people are just dying to get in. We don't want people dying to get in the church, right? We want dead people that are living to get in the church.
Amen.
They're on the outside, they're dead, but then they're coming into the church and they're becoming alive in Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit's filling them and giving them life.
Yes, thank you.
Right?
Thank you, Lord.
They become a living person.
Yes.
Amen.
Instead of the dead corpse.
Amen.
That they used to be. We can only do that by being alive in ourselves. And I'm going to tell you this. Any member that has been cut off from the body dies. If you don't believe me, let's follow the science. You know, they like to say that nowadays, right? Follow the science. Follow the science. We're going to follow the science. If you take a body part like an arm or a leg and you put a tourniquet on it, so that it doesn't get blood going to it, what happens to it? The first thing it does is it starts turning blue, right? Why? Because there's no blood going to it. And if you leave that tourniquet on too long, what happens without the blood going to it? That part of the body dies. When we get cut off from the blood supply of the church, all right, hear me. When we get cut off from the blood supply of the church, we begin to die. All right? So let's get that tourniquet off and get that blood restored. And that blood is the blood restored by Jesus Christ.
Yes, hallelujah.
Stand with me, please. In Matthew chapter 8, Jesus refers to those who do not follow him as spiritually dead. He never meant for us to be alive in the flesh, but to carry a dead spirit. So if you're here today, or you're on Facebook Live, or maybe you're on YouTube, and you're alive physically, but you've been carrying a dead spirit, let me introduce you to the blood donor who can make you alive. Right? He can revive the dead by his living water. Or perhaps you've had a spiritual tourniquet applied to your spirit, and you need that blood restored. Only one person can apply his blood to restore that life. If that's you today, I just want you to pray with me. Just say, Jesus, I've been alive physically, but I have a dead spirit inside of me, Lord. Lord, I don't want to carry a corpse anymore.
Restore my soul.
But Lord, I want you to come in and make me truly alive. Apply your blood to my spirit. Breathe your life, Holy Spirit, into me. Lord, I've had a tourniquet applied to my spirit, and it's not getting the blood that it needs, Lord. Jesus, remove that tourniquet of this world that's been choking it out, God. Lord, restore to me your blood and my spirit that I may remain alive in you, Lord. Lord, today I dedicate myself to you, to be alive to you and dead to the world, that I will receive the garment of white of your righteousness, and that I can be introduced to the Father as your boy, as your girl. Lord, today, I give myself to you in Jesus' name. Make this song part of here, part of your prayer.
So far.
If you prayed that prayer with me today and you're here, I want to invite you to come up for prayer right after we give the blessing. If you are on Facebook or you're on YouTube, message me. Just say, Pastor, pray for me because I do want to pray for you. So I'm going to ask you while you're standing, if you would just raise your hand to receive the blessing of the Lord today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord to make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. You may go in Jesus' name. Amen.